Dear audience, welcome to the show Power Chat. Today we are going to discuss about the relationship between Nepal and Bangladesh. Next half an hour we will be discussing the relationship of Nepal and Bangladesh. Joining us today is Ms. Maspi Binte Shams, Ambassador of Bangladesh to Nepal. Please allow me to welcome her. Welcome to the show, Your Excellency.
Thank you for inviting me.
How have you been?
I've been very fine. Nepal is a wonderful place to be, so I've been very well.
And since you are here for last 3 years, have you visited some places here?
I have visited quite a lot of places, especially in the Tarai, and of course everybody goes to Pokhara. So it's been a wonderful experience, you know, to go around. It's such a beautiful country and the people are so friendly. So I love it here.
And what are the common things that Nepal and Bangladesh share with?
Oh, we have so much in common. Take the language, for instance. There is so much similarity between our languages. I think almost 30% of the words are similar. Then the cultural, you know, the rites, the religious rites, culture, songs, music, everything is the food. There is a lot of similarities between Bangladesh and Nepal.
So for last 3 years you are here and you have enjoyed when it comes to the culture and language and other traditional things that in
yes,
Bangladesh and Nepal.
The good thing is you don't feel that you're in a foreign country, you feel that you're almost at home.
Well, that's good, and we'll be discussing more on the bilateral relationship between Nepal and Bangladesh. Mm-hmm. To begin with, would you tell us about the foundations of Nepal-Bangladesh relationships?
Well, Bangladesh and Nepal relationship actually goes back very far. You know, there was this Buddhist scholar, Atisha Dipankara, who came from a village near Dhaka in Bangladesh. And in the 12th century, he traveled all the way from Bangladesh through Nepal. He stayed in Kathmandu, he went to Mushtang, and then he went to Tibet. And he right from that period we have relationship. And then very recent, in 1907, in the Royal Nepal Museum, they found the earliest written script of Bengali. It was preserved in your Royal Museum, and that dates back to the 7th century. So you can imagine, I mean, this relationship goes back centuries. Of course, diplomatic relations between Bangladesh and Nepal was established in 1972. When Nepal recognized Bangladesh after our liberation.
So Nepal was
the eighth country
to recognize Bangladesh.
Yeah, in January 1972. Mm-hmm. But of course, Nepalese people expressed their support, and in fact, a lot of Nepali political leaders, they took even arms into Bangladesh during the War of Liberation to help the Mukti Bahini. Mm-hmm. And in recognition for that, you know, 11 distinguished personalities were honored as friends of Bangladesh by the government.
Those from Nepal?
From Nepal.
And that was during the liberation movement of Bangladesh?
They helped during the liberation movement, and this recognition was delayed because of various reasons. And in 2012 and 2013, we had the ceremony where we honored a lot of our foreign friends who had helped us, not only Nepalese, Indian, Bhutanese, Americans, British. Among them, there were 11 distinguished Nepalese, and they are friends of Bangladesh, recognized for their contribution to our liberation war.
Your Excellency, this is very interesting to know that Nepal shares a very cordial relationship with Bangladesh, and that traces back to centuries. Both in terms of the culture, history, and later on the politics. So in the recent days, since you engaged in so many international missions, especially that of the regional level, you worked with different countries in different capacities on behalf of Bangladesh. We have an entity called SAARC, and Bangladesh and Nepal both are the members of SAARC. And what are the regional issues taking place around, and how Nepal and Bangladesh, both countries, could benefit from the regional strategies or the regional forums?
Actually, promotion of regional cooperation is one of the main pillars of our foreign policy. You know, the government of Bangladesh, we firmly believe that the entire region has to develop together. It's no use having only one country of the region having very fast economic growth, because otherwise that will lead to instability because of, you know, migration, economic instability, and it will complicate issues. So we have to develop together, and for that we have to have regional cooperation. So in fact, it was Bangladesh which first floated the idea of SAARC, to mm-hmm. have all the countries of South Asia cooperate together. Then we are also members of BIMSTEC, which is another, it's a trans-regional. It's, mm-hmm. it combines the countries of ASEAN, because Thailand and Myanmar are members of it, and also some of the SAARC countries. In addition to that, you know, we are also talking of sub-regional cooperation, like the BBIN, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, mm-hmm. As a part from the SAARC, because, you know, SAARC is so big, and all the countries of the region may not have similar issues. So the countries that do have similarity, we can get together and work. And even smaller, we can talk of trilateral cooperation between Bangladesh, India, and Nepal, or yeah. Bangladesh, India, Bhutan. So that way, we believe that there is a lot of scope for cooperating together. For example, in trade, you know, trade, connectivity, and connectivity is not only transit or, you know, railroads. It's connectivity like telecommunications, connectivity of media, connectivity of human resources. So we believe closer integration in all these areas will help to boost the economies of the countries together.
You raised a very important issue of how countries come together, not only in terms of the bilateral but trilateral, and many countries in this region are sometimes have some misunderstanding, but most of the time they come together and they have a strategy for the regional development as well. When it comes to the relationship between Bangladesh and Nepal, as you already mentioned, it traces back to centuries. And in the recent days, you know, there is a development of trade and transportation, and also you mentioned about the media. Media in Nepal, you know, there is tremendous development. And what we notice in Bangladesh as well, there is good growth of the media institutions along with the academic locations. So how do you observe the development of academic institutions in both countries, since you are also here? And how do you also observe the development of media alongside the countries?
Well, I think media has a very important role to play in the promotion of bilateral relations. One of my major irritations, if you would like to mm-hmm. put it that way, is that there is nothing directly between direct, there is no direct interaction between the medias of the two countries. In the press, you will see most of the stories are reflected from AFP or Reuters or something. Right. There is hardly any direct news. And if there was, you know, direct exchange, I think there would be a lot of the stories that are printed or reflected would be much more honest, or much would reflect the reality much more,
right.
because we understand each other's concerns, and they would be much more, you know, they would be more factual based, I think.
What is your recommendation to media of both countries, so that, as you said, there is direct involvement of the stories, or direct engagement of media to these stories? They are not based on the international news agencies alone.
Well, most of all, there must be exchange.
And how that makes a difference by directly covering these stories from the authorities or the sources of both countries?
You know, like when there was the earthquake, so many you know, media houses from Bangladesh sent their representatives here, you know, the TV channels, the newspapers, they came here and to see for themselves exactly what had happened, and they reported to Bangladesh. And that's why there was this huge outpouring of humanitarian assistance from Bangladesh. You know, that helped, because these people came, they saw, they reported, they carried back the stories with them. And you know, Bangladesh, within our small capacity, we have tried our best to help Nepal during the earthquake. We have sent 10,000 metric ton rice, and we are sending another 10,000 metric tons. We sent a medical team, and besides that, we sent many other materials. So that's what I mean by direct, you know, contact. So similarly, you know, during not only during big events, you know, for any small cultural programs also, we could have direct reporting. Maybe somebody, you know, you can't always send a media team from one country to the other, but maybe you could have a representative, a Nepali journalist could represent a media house from Bangladesh.
Well, you know, Kathmandu and Dhaka, the cities are not so far.
Mm-hmm.
If we take flight, it's about 1 hour.
Exactly.
And there was much talked issue about linking Kathmandu and Dhaka by bus. There was a proposal, in fact, to link both cities so that the trade and transportation become easier. What is your observation about the proposed direct bus link or transportation and trade link between Kathmandu and Dhaka?
That is a very something that is very dear to our hearts because we had proposed it. Actually, I think the Dhaka Kathmandu bus service has been taken over by the motor vehicle agreement that was signed by between Bhutan, Bangladesh, India, and Nepal. So four countries signed it in last June. And it will come into effect when all the countries ratify it. So now Bangladesh, India, and Nepal have ratified it. We are waiting for Bhutan to complete the process. Once that takes over, then that will mean absolutely free movement of passengers.
So you mean that the route goes back to India and Bhutan as well?
Well, you can have crisscross. You can come directly from Kathmandu to Dhaka. You can take your car. You don't even have to wait for a bus. You can take your car from Kathmandu. You can travel all the way to Chittagong in the port or go to Cox Bazar. Or somebody from Dhaka may want to come and visit anywhere in Nepal, or they can go to Bhutan. From Nepal, you can take your car, go to Bhutan or anywhere, you know, it will be free movement of vehicles.
Well, that idea should be materialized soon, hopefully.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are many students going to Dhaka every year, especially that of the medical studies, and in the recent days the other areas of social sciences, there is a tendency of Nepali students going Dhaka, and they are studying there, especially that of the medical studies, aiming to be a doctor. And how Bangladesh facilitates students going to Bangladesh for their higher studies, especially that of the medical ones and other subjects as well?
Well, we are very lucky because Nepali students prefer Bangladesh, and I think they feel at home because of the similarities that I mentioned earlier, similarity of food, language, culture. And we are very happy to welcome all these Nepali students there. We are getting Nepali students in the government institutions as well as in the private education institutions. We encourage the students to interact with the embassy directly, so that way we can help them without going through any other indirect process, because then they can get the accurate information about the universities, and they can even save money without having to pay any other fees and all. They can directly pay whatever fees are absolutely necessary without going through.
What do you think, Your Excellency, the reason behind Nepali students going to Bangladesh? It is due to the quality education?
Number one,
they coming back to Nepal? What is your observation? Or they are going abroad or continuing their studies and work there?
Most of the students that I talk to, they say they come back. Right. They are all coming back. It's quality education, but it's at a competitive price compared to like India or mm-hmm. China. Or even other countries. And then I think the closeness, it's only 1 hour by plane, and if you take a bus, you can
from
come
from the eastern part of Nepal.
Yeah, via Kakarhita, mm-hmm. you can come. Mm-hmm. So I think the close proximity is also another factor, and also because they feel very comfortable there, I think.
Tourism is one of the crucial issues of this region, SAARC region. And the countries including Bangladesh or Nepal or India, Bhutan, there are many borders that the countries are linked with. And what is your idea, or what is your observation about the development of tourism in both countries, or the countries linking around?
Well, tourism is so important because, you know, Bangladesh, we are one of your largest tourist receiving. I mean, we are
after India.
Yeah, in South Asia, we are the second.
Second.
Last year, we about 25,000 Bangladeshis came to Nepal, and you know, this number is going to increase because as more Bangladeshis become affluent, because now we are, you know, our per capita income is increasing, so Bangladeshis have learned the love of traveling, and since Kathmandu is only 1 hour flight away, and there is no visa on arrival. So those advantages are there, and you know, we, our topography is totally flat, plain. We don't have any mountains
in Bangladesh.
Yeah. So when they come here and they see the Himalayas, it's so wonderful for them. It's like a novelty. So everybody loves to come to Nepal, and I think this will keep on increasing. On the other hand, from Nepal, we are trying to attract the Buddhist pilgrims to go to the various Buddhist sites in Bangladesh. We have some major Buddhist heritage sites, and also we have the beautiful beaches of Cox Bazar. So for Nepalese who wish to you know, see, enjoy the sea beach and things like that, we would like to encourage them to visit Bangladesh. A lot of Bangladeshis are also investing, or are very interested to invest in the tourism sector, you know, in the hospitality, restaurants, hotels, boutique hotels. So I think that will be it's something that will grow in the future.
What should be done so that the investors from your country or the investors from Nepal, they have a partnership for the development of tourism in both countries?
You know, as I said, the interest is already there. What now we need to do is have this, because the investors need to be protected, so we need to have some sort of an agreement, like a bilateral investment promotion agreement or protection agreement. I think your investment act is also being updated, so maybe that, once that is also done, our investors will feel more secure. So
you mean the protection of the investors or the protection of the business itself?
Protection of the investment.
Investment.
And I think it's something that will automatically grow, because there is a lot of interest in Bangladesh or in Nepali tourism.
And would you say something about the individuals or the people living in Bangladesh, especially you mentioned of the Buddhist pilgrimage here, and Nepal, since it is a diverse country, and there are many religious groups here, and religion is one thing that sometimes is crucial for the visits and tourism development. So what is the population division of Bangladesh in terms of religion?
Well, we are a Muslim majority country, but we are a secular country, and we believe that you know, religion is everybody's personal issue. Being a Muslim majority country, like, it's more than 90% Muslim. Of course, there is a huge presence. If you go to Bangladesh, you will naturally feel that it's a Muslim country. But in you know, we have absolute security.
But the country maintains religious tolerance.
Absolute tolerance between the Buddhists and the Christians and the Hindus, and we all celebrate all the festivals together. You know, Muslims are going to the Hindu festivals like the Durga Puja, and then we have this recently we had the birth anniversary of Lord Buddha, so that was also celebrated in a big way. Christmas is of course a fun festival for everybody. We have this.
Do you see religious majorities participating in the activities of other religions?
Yes.
90 plus percentage of the Muslims living in Bangladesh. Do they participate in the
activities? Yes, we all go. Yes, we all go to the Puja Mandap during the Durga Puja. It's a huge festival in Bangladesh. We are all going there to see what's going on. There are songs and music, and it's just like a lot of big festival.
And we discuss a lot about the Bangladesh and Nepal relationships, and since you represent it in many forums from your country, and what are the ideas or what are the issues that maintains regional peace in this region, especially that of the SAARC?
Peace will of course
What are the issues that the SAARC member countries should always take care of so that there is peace, prosperity and development in this region?
Well, firstly, we must all focus on development, on socio-economic development. You know, we are still one of the poorest regions of the world, and we are so deprived, our people are so deprived. We must ensure that every person in this region has food to eat, all the children get education, they have schools, they can go to schools, and that's where we must all collectively work together. And luckily we are all moving forward in that direction. You know, we have all Nepal, Bangladesh, we have all mostly achieved the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals. We are on track to achieving the middle income status. Bangladesh has targeted 2021. We are already a lower middle income country. Nepal will also hopefully graduate very soon. So we are moving in the right direction. While we look for development, we must also make sure that we take everybody along, that nobody is left behind. It should be a very homogeneous development, and there should not be pockets of deprivation anywhere.
How do you think about the deprivation or the marginalization of the people in both countries? You know, we have very good plan in the papers, but there is always a voice that some certain groups are always deprived from the rights. So what concrete measures should be taken to address the development rights of the people not having access to the state facilities?
You know, it's a big challenge in countries like Bangladesh and Nepal. For example, in Bangladesh, I mean, the numbers are so huge. We have a huge population. It's 160 million people. And
but the area, it is almost the same as
Nepal.
So it's a high population.
It's a high population density. Mm-hmm. But within that, we have managed to become self-sufficient in food. We are now the fifth largest producer of rice, and fourth largest producer of freshwater fish
globally.
Mm-hmm. And feeding 160 million people 3 meals a day is a huge challenge, but we are managing it. And within that, of course, there will be pockets of deprivation which we are trying to address with decentralization of administration, with decentralization of the political system. And for Bangladesh, it's comparatively easier because of the connectivity, because it's a flat country, anywhere to anywhere you can connect.
Can travel.
With roads and rails, it's very easy to connect. It's much more difficult in Nepal. As I said, for you, the challenge is geography. For us, the challenge is the sheer numbers. For example, this year, on the first day of the year, the government distributes school textbooks free to all the children, and it's all done on 1st of January. And this year the number is incredible. It's 333 million books
distributed to schools
mm-hmm. among all the school going children. So can you imagine the scale mm-hmm. of distribution? I mean, it's a huge undertaking. Mm-hmm. It's a challenge, but I think the governments are moving in the right direction.
You know, you mentioned that both countries are underdeveloped countries, and there are some mechanisms. Sometimes Bangladesh shares, sometimes Nepal shares it with the common platform that was shared by both countries, LDC as well, least developed countries shares. How do you feel that sharing the least developed countries and constantly, sticking towards the commitments of development in international forum and by international organizations? Both countries are listed under some corruption index. And what do you think the issues connecting corruption or the underdeveloped issues be eradicated in both countries so that everyone believes in the state system, everyone feels that there is a good governance? What is your idea? Suggestions.
That's a very big subject that you mentioned, because countries, first of all, I always say that we are not least developed or we are not poor, because culturally we have very rich culture. traditionally, historically, Bangladesh and Nepal, we are both very rich, and traditionally we have been rich. It's only with the advent of colonialism and this new colonialism mm-hmm. that we have had the misfortune to be on the wrong side of colonialism.
Mm-hmm.
And for Bangladesh, we have started our journey for.
Do you mean that is still affecting the country, Bangladesh?
Of course it is. You cannot write away 200 years of misrule.
Mm-hmm.
And we are feeling the effects of it, because during colonial era, our entire system was shattered and destroyed. Our economy was destroyed. Our political systems were destroyed. Everything was destroyed. And Bangladesh, we started our journey only since 1971, but even then, there were a lot of disruptions. And corruption or misgovernance, these are all matters of perception.
Both countries always in the media or in the stories for not maintaining good governance in the country. That's why I asked you this question. And maybe, yes, it is vague, and concrete steps should be, forwarded, I believe.
I think here the media has a very important role.
Exactly. Exactly. And we are coming to the end of this show. Do you have anything to say to our audiences that I have not asked to you?
Well, I would just like to say that Bangladesh considers Nepal to be a wonderful friend, to be one of our closest neighbors, and we are there to work together with Nepal as towards our future prosperity.
Thank you very much for your time, Your Excellency.
Thank you.
Dear audience, we have come to the end of the show, Power Chat. Keep watching us. See you next week. Namaste.
You're in a foreign country, you feel that you're almost at home.
Well, that's good, and we'll be discussing more on the bilateral relationship between Nepal and Bangladesh.
Mm-hmm.
To begin with, would you tell us about the foundations of Nepal-Bangladesh relationships?
Well, Bangladesh and Nepal relationship actually goes back very far. There was this Buddhist scholar, Atisha Dipankara, who came from a village near Dhaka in Bangladesh, and in the 12th century he traveled all the way from Bangladesh through Nepal. He stayed in Kathmandu, he went to Mushtang, and then he went to Tibet. And right from that period we have relationship. And then very recent, in 1907, in the Royal Nepal Museum, they found the earliest written script of Bengali. It was preserved in your Royal Museum, and that dates back to the 7th century. So you can imagine, this relationship goes back centuries. Of course, diplomatic relations between Bangladesh and Nepal was established in 1972. When Nepal recognized Bangladesh after our liberation.
So Nepal was
eighth country
to recognize Bangladesh.
Yeah, in January 1972.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, Nepalese people expressed their support. And in fact, a lot of Nepali political leaders, they took even arms into Bangladesh during the War of Liberation to help the Mukti Bahini.
Mm-hmm.
And in recognition for that, 11 distinguished personalities were honored as friends of Bangladesh by the government.
Those from Nepal?
From Nepal.
And that was during the liberation movement of Bangladesh?
They helped during the liberation.
And what we notice in Bangladesh as well, there is good growth of the media institutions along with the academic locations. So how do you observe the development of academic institutions in both countries, since you are also here? And how do you also observe the development of media alongside the countries?
Well, I think media has a very important role to play in the promotion of bilateral relations. One of my major irritations, if you would like to put it that way, is that there is nothing directly between direct, there is no direct interaction between the medias of the two countries. In the press, you will see most of the stories are reflected from AFP or Reuters or something. Right. There is hardly any direct news. And in if there was, you know, direct exchange, I think there would be a lot of the stories that are printed or reflected would be much more honest or much would reflect the reality much more, because we understand each other's concerns, and they would be much more, you know, they would have, they would be more factual based, I think.
What is your recommendation to media of both countries so that, as you said, there is direct involvement of these stories or direct engagement of media to these stories? They are not based on the international news agencies alone.
Well, most of all, there must be exchange.
And how that makes a difference by directly covering these stories from the authorities or the sources of both countries?
You know, like when there was the earthquake, so many you know, media houses from Bangladesh sent their representatives here, you know, the TV channels, the newspapers, they came here and to.
Dear audience, welcome to the show Power Chat. Today we are going to discuss about the relationship between Nepal and Bangladesh. Next half an hour we will be discussing the relationship of Nepal and Bangladesh. Joining us today is Ms. Masfi Binte Shams, Ambassador of Bangladesh to Nepal. Please allow me to welcome her. Welcome to the show, Your Excellency.
Thank you for inviting me.
How have you been?
I've been very fine. Nepal is a wonderful place to be, so I've been very well.
And since you are here for last 3 years, have you visited some places here?
I have visited quite a lot of places, especially in the Tarai, and of course everybody goes to Pokhara. So it's been a wonderful experience, you know, to go around. It's such a beautiful country and the people are so friendly. So I love it here.
And what are the common things that Nepal and Bangladesh share with?
Oh, we have so much in common. Take the language, for instance. There is so much similarity between our languages. I think almost 30% of the words are similar. Then the cultural, you know, the rites, the religious rites, culture, songs, music, everything is the food. There's a lot of similarities between Bangladesh and Nepal.
So for last 3 years you are here and you have enjoyed when it comes to the culture and language and other traditional things that in Bangladesh and Nepal.
They are also members of BIMSTEC, which is another, it's a trans-regional. It's, it combines the countries of ASEAN, because Thailand and Myanmar are members of it, and also some of the SAARC countries. In addition to that, you know, we are also talking of sub-regional cooperation, like the BBIN, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, as a part from the SAARC, because, you know, SAARC is so big, and all the countries of the region may not have similar issues. So the countries that do have similarity, we can get together and work. And even smaller, we can talk of trilateral cooperation between Bangladesh, India and Nepal, or Bangladesh, India, Bhutan. So that way we believe that there is a lot of scope for cooperating together, for example, in trade, you know, trade, connectivity. And connectivity is not only transit or, you know, railroads, it's connectivity like telecommunications, connectivity of media, connectivity of human resources. So we believe closer integration in all these areas will help to boost the economies of the countries together.
You raised a very important issue of how countries come together, not only in terms of the bilateral but trilateral, and many countries in this region are sometimes have some misunderstanding, but most of the time they come together and they have a strategy for the regional development as well. When it comes to the relationship between Bangladesh and Nepal, as you already mentioned, it traces back to centuries. And in the recent days, you know, there is a development of trade and transportation, and also you mentioned about the media. Media in Nepal, you know, there is tremendous development.
Movement, and this recognition was delayed because of various reasons. And in 2012 and 2013, we had the ceremony where we honored a lot of our foreign friends who had helped us, not only Nepalese, Indian, Bhutanese, Americans, British. Among them, there were 11 distinguished Nepalese, and they are friends of Bangladesh, recognized for their contribution to our liberation war.
Your Excellency, this is very interesting to know that Nepal shares a very cordial relationship with Bangladesh, and that traces back to centuries, both in terms of the culture, history, and later on the politics. So in the recent days, since you engaged in so many international missions, especially that of the regional level, you worked with different countries in different capacities on behalf of Bangladesh. We have an entity called SAARC, and Bangladesh and Nepal both are the members of SAARC. And what are the regional issues taking place around, and how Nepal and Bangladesh, both countries, could benefit from the regional strategies or the regional forums?
Actually, promotion of regional cooperation is one of the main pillars of our foreign policy. You know, the government of Bangladesh, we firmly believe that the entire region has to develop together. It's no use having only one country of the region having very fast economic growth, because otherwise that will lead to instability because of, you know, migration, economic instability, and it will complicate issues. So we have to develop together, and for that we have to have regional cooperation. So in fact, it was Bangladesh which first floated the idea of SAARC, to have all the countries of South Asia cooperate together. Then we are